Sunscreen, protecting us from the evil sun since 1936. What would we do without it? Well, to be honest, we probably have far less instances of skin cancer. Yes, you heard that right. We'd have less skin cancer. More people are diagnosed every year with skin cancer than all the other cancers combined. Skin cancer has grown into a highly profitable $8.1 billion a year industry. Over the last 20 years, instances of skin cancer have increased over 300%. According to the American Cancer Society, one person now dies of melanoma every hour. There's something really strange about this to me, especially since during this exact same time period, we've seen a massive population level epidemic in vitamin D deficiencies, one of the reasons of which researchers claim is due to decreased sun exposure. So why are we getting more skin cancer than ever while we're decreasing our exposure to the sun? Seems fishy. As a disclaimer to this video, I personally think skin cancer is much more complex than just involving chemical exposure to the skin. The topic that I'm going to discuss in this video today is just about the chemical exposure. The full extent of skin cancer is likely linked to factors from the diet, chemicals on the skin, micronutrient deficiencies, stress, and atmospheric pollution, a multifaceted cause. However, today I'm going to expose a huge truth that cannot be ignored any longer. Commercial sunscreens all contain several chemicals that are US government classified carcinogens. I'm about to show you actual chemicals that you can find in nearly every mainstream sunscreen we've been told to use since we were kids that are well known in government and research circles to cause cancer in humans. Why these are still being sold to us as a cancer prevention, I have no idea. You can make your own conclusions about that. There's so much shady shit going on these days with poisoning our health that sometimes it's difficult to really wrap my head around how all of these things seem to always be pointing back to the same sources. Conspiracy aside, let's look at the cold hard facts. The following common sunscreen chemicals cause cancer, tumor growth, free radical damage, and are all well-known endocrine disrupting substances. Chemical number one, benzophenone. Well, first off, benzophenone is actually a known cancer-causing agent on the top 65 list in California. You can find that right on the internet. Quick Google search. In this study right here, the researchers showed the carcinogenicity of benzophenone in experimental animals. Apparently, no human subjects were available for testing. I wonder why. Obviously, don't want to be doing that, and they don't want to be showing people that. This study right here on benzophenone showed that, and this is crazy, breast cancer cells, when exposed to benzophenone, caused massive augmentation. It literally made the cancer cells grow a measurable amount during the study. This study right here showed an increase in the case of renal cancer in male rats and an increase in leukemia and nephropathy. So there's a big, you know, issue with this chemical on the kidney. This study's pretty significant and really supports the carcinogenesis involved with this chemical and your exposure to this chemical. Article right here, it showed that the chemical makeup of this chemical can actually inhibit thyroid peroxidase and therefore inhibit the thyroid hormone pathway in general. This may be a contributor to the current huge hypothyroidism epidemic that's going on at population level right now. And this is actually even more pronounced in cases where people are deficient in iodide. The second chemical we have is 4-MBC. There are a million names for this thing, so it can show up under a lot of different names. This study showed a variety of chemicals in the breast tissue, including the 4-MBC in women that were undergoing a mastectomy. Out of the 7 women who had the 4-MBC concentrations present in their breasts, 6 of them actually had it at the tumor site. So it was showing up where the tumors were growing. So this study showed that with dermal exposure to hairless rats, the rats actually had a dose-dependent increase in uterine weight from the 4-MBC. This study right here correlated the 4-MBC along with a couple other UV filters, these other chemicals that I'm mentioning here, to a greater indication of neuroblastoma and showed that they have some gonadal and thyroid hormone inhibiting effects. So reproductive and thyroid hormones. Again, a lot of this goes back to all these chemicals are damaging our reproductive hormones and they're damaging our thyroid. So the third chemical is avobenzone. Again, a lot of different names that this can slide under. I mean, if you see anything like any of these names, you know, with these crazy chemical formulas, like you probably shouldn't be around your skin. That's just common sense. This study right here showed that there was a massive amount of free radical production when this chemical was specifically exposed to the sun. So this chemical is supposed to protect you from the sun, and when it is exposed to the sun, it degrades immediately and turns into a huge free radical stress on your skin. Okay, that makes sense.
Dad, you're so sunburnt.
I can't move because it hurts too bad.
Ugh, this is awful.
So this study right here showed that the use of the avobenzone along with a few other of these chemicals that I'm mentioning right here in combination, so basically a sunscreen, caused an increase in the production of inflammatory cytokines, which the cytokines are basically a huge biomarker indicator of inflammation, including tumor necrosis factor and alpha and interleukin 6. The study also indicated, and they mentioned that these signaling pathways were increased between 2 and 10-fold. So massive, massive increases. So chemical number 4 is homosalate. Again, different names for it that it can go under. In this handbook of cancer prevention on page 21, they list that the in vivo effects of this chemical and the fact that it actually does have a mutagenesis effect for increasing instances of cancer. They concluded that since it was just during the use of sunscreen and just in vivo that it should be safe to use. However, I'm not really sure what that means. I mean, it's showing to cause cancer when you use it from sunscreen, so I'm not sure how that's safe, whatever. These recommendations, you gotta take stuff with a grain of salt with some of this, the research recommendations. You have to use a little bit of your own common sense. All right, the chemical number 5, we got OctoCrylene. So this study right here showed that, again, OctoCrylene in combination with these other UV filter chemicals that I'm talking about here increased reactive oxygen species production on the skin. At about the 60-minute mark, the amount of reactive oxygen species, ROS, on the skin exceeded that of the control group. So it took about an hour to get a massive boost in the basically free radical damage on the skin. So this study right here showed, again, when exposure to OctoCrylene, a large increase of free radicals, an accumulation of free radicals on the skin when there was an increase in exposure. And then this article right here from the Dermatology Review, it showed that there was a paradox with this chemical causing free radical damage on the skin, even though it was meant to reduce the amount of free radicals produced. And, you know, there was a claim that it is a minimal side effect. However, you know, several studies showing the exact same effect when people use the OctoCrylene. They're literally increasing free radical damage and inflammation on the skin when exposed to sun. So. All right, the next chemical is Octinoxate. And octinoxate has been shown in this study that it's going to produce free radicals and more free radicals on the skin, as well as when it's combined with the avobenzone, it persisted, and they had to stop the exposure to this chemical because it got so bad in that study. And since you guys know that I really heavily believe that the key to health is hormone optimization, I put together a list here of the hormone disrupting side effects of these chemicals as well, and there are a lot of them. So let's go through benzophenone as well. This study showed that basically the uterine weights of the subjects were increased 4-fold, 4x, when exposed to benzophenone. This study right here showed that benzophenone itself was able to attach itself to the estrogen receptor, literally to bind the estrogen receptor, and had these uterotrophic effects, which are uterine growth effects, on rats who were ovaryectomized. Pronounce that correctly. So that basically they had their ovaries taken out. So it was like independent of having ovaries, they were growing their uterus. This study right here was really interesting. So they went all the way to the genetic level to look at the effect that this had on the hormonal pathways of the male zebrafish. And before you guys say anything, I mean, they picked these animals for a reason. I remember I studied neuroscience at Duke. The zebrafish is a very common endocrine and neuronal subject for a lot of studies because of similarities in the nervous system to humans. So it showed that the chemical, this benzophenone, caused estrogenic activity in the embryos and the brains of the fish. So the European Commission has also listed benzophenone as a chemical that has the potential to cause endocrine disruption. So it's well known by governments. So this study right here showed a dose-dependent increase in estrogen receptor binding of benzophenone with the derivative that was competing with the 17-beta-estradiol molecule. And it basically supports the claim that this benzophenone chemical is a xenoestrogen that does bind human estrogen receptors. All right, now 4-MBC also has some research showing its endocrine disrupting effects. This study, they included these other chemicals as well, but they showed that there were negative effects induced by these chemicals in animals, which include reproductive effects and developmental toxicity and disruption of the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. Very, very important axis. Anything that's damaging your hypothalamic pituitary axis in general, which communicates with your thyroid, with your and with your gonads, and with your kidneys and, you know, other organs, anything that disrupts the hypothalamic pituitary axis is no good. So this study right here, again, on the male zebrafish, showed that exposure to the benzophenone and camphor UV filters like 4-MBC had a massive feminization effect. So they basically saw that it caused this vitellogenin, which is a blood protein that's usually only present in females. It caused an increase in males, and it caused alterations in the gonads, along with a decrease in fertility and reproduction. So if you want to castrate yourself as a guy, you might as well go. You can go rub some 4-MBC on your skin. So this study showed that 4-MBC compound, the compound itself, can elicit estrogen receptor alpha and beta activity. So this study on the madaka, which is a Japanese fish, showed an increase in production of this vitellogenin again and coriogenin, which are basically female blood proteins, or they're highly expressed in the female, you know, ecosystem, like biological ecosystem, as well as an increase in the mRNA expression of estrogen receptor alpha in the liver. So this study showed that there was actually a decrease of testosterone levels after the application of this 4-MBC and other sunscreens. So literally putting sunscreen on your skin is going to decrease your testosterone levels. All right, so homosalate, we've got a few studies here. This study took six of these UV filters, including the homosalate, and they all had estrogenic effects and endocrine disrupting effects. They were able to bind to estrogen receptor sites in different pathways than regular estrogen molecules. So it had a more far-reaching estrogenic effect than even regular, you know, endogenous estrogen. So this study took a look at 18 different UV filters, again, including homosalate, and they showed that every single one of them has an estrogenic effect, most of them having multiple effects, not just one single estrogen effect. So it has far-reaching effects. This study right here showed and they looked at a couple of these salicylate compounds that can be found in sunscreens, as well as a couple of the camphor compounds, and they found distinctive estrogenic and anti-androgenic activity. Again, why are we rubbing this stuff on our skin? Come on. So a study was done, and they found the estrogenic effects, again, of all these filters, including the homosalate, and they looked at the androgen receptor effects of the filters. The anti-androgen effects of these compounds included the inhibition of gene expression of the DHT-induced luciferase molecule and a few others as well. This study showed that the effect that musk fragrances have, so one thing with homosalate, it can be found in colognes and stuff, that it had a negative effect on it. You know, basically it increased estrogen, had a bad effect on the androgen levels and on the protective hormone progesterone. It showed that they inhibit the estrogen receptor alpha, that they inhibit androgen receptors, and they inhibit progesterone receptors. So OctoCrylene, basically they exposed, in this study, they exposed OctoCrylene to rats and a couple of these other chemicals. They were fed pre-mating, during pregnancy, post-pregnancy with these chemicals. The neonatal effect was an enlarged prostate, delayed puberty, altered uterine gene expression, and they all these chemicals affected the reproductive organ weights. And as if this is not bad enough, this study right here showed that the use of sunscreen increased the skin absorption of herbicides and pesticides when it was used. So let's add some more heavy metals and endocrine disruptors to the mix. Why don't we? So the skin is our largest organ. Obviously, it's the most absorbable and reactive to the outside world. Why the hell would we want to rub all this nasty shit on our skin directly into our bloodstreams?
Oh my God, look at Stewie! Peter, you took him out without any sunscreen?
Maybe.
You know the sun is dangerous for a baby's skin.
Now, most of you at this point are probably wondering what you can do to naturally protect yourself from the sun. Subscribe to this channel because I'm going to drop a full video with all of my recommendations. Protecting your skin and not burning in the sun is actually a multifaceted thing. It heavily involves your diet. This might seem like a foreign concept to people since most people don't view the skin for what it really is, which is a reflection of your internal health. As within, so without. Skin problems are indicative of internal health issues. When your health is solid internally, you may be surprised to find out that your skin is extremely good at protecting itself from outside damage and stress. Now, of course, a part of this whole equation is reducing exposure on your skin from outside free radical species, chemicals, and other stressors. So I'm going to go into some detail about what you can do there as well. Subscribe to this channel, hit the notification bell, and you'll be notified when that video is released. Hey guys, thanks so much for watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel because I've got so much more content coming out for you to teach you exactly the truth about health-related topics and what you can really do to empower your own life and your own health. So thanks for watching. Click on some other videos, watch some other stuff, and I'll see you around.